Hello, everybody. Thank you so much for tuning in yet again to the Deep Dive Lyrics podcast. Now, I know you have not heard from me in a full 2 weeks. It's been 2 weeks since I've put out an episode. And I apologize for that. Obviously, you are aware, if you're paying attention, that over here in the United States, we are going through a tough time. It's been some tragic times for us lately. However, this is not a podcast about current events, and so we won't be speaking to that anymore, but it is a podcast where each week I bring a song to you that has some significant meaning behind it or some ambiguity behind it that we can talk about and explore and try to figure out. And it's just a podcast dedicated to the exploration and attempt to interpret what in some cases are difficult lyrics. And the song that we are talking about today comes from a band from the 70s, 60s and 70s called Bread. It is known to be a good example of the soft rock genre, the style of music. And the song that we're going to be talking about is called London Bridge. It was recorded in 1969. And concerning the history of the London Bridge, there's actually some interesting things going on at that time. So I will be sharing that with you quickly. First, let me just tell you that if you have any desire to make communication with me, if you have any suggestions for songs to be done in the future, or if you have a desire to come on the show and talk about a song, we can have a little recorded conversation about a song. You can write me at deepdivelyrics.crow@gmail.com. deepdivelyrics.crow@gmail.com. And if you have any comments or questions or any ideas, thoughts at all, I would be very, very grateful to hear from you over there. Now, let's go ahead and get into, sometimes on the show we like to do a little bit of history, a little bit of background on the song or on the musicians. I'm going to go ahead and tell you a little bit about London Bridge, and it will kind of, I think, help to interpret the song as I play it for you. In a little bit, I'll play my own little version of the song for you. But first, let me give you a little bit of background information that might be helpful. Really, the history of the London Bridge is just a history of this thing. It's obviously, it's a bridge in London, if that wasn't very clear, spanning the River Thames, which is the correct pronunciation of that river's name, I have found. It's a history of this bridge that was just constantly, perpetually breaking down and having to be built back up. And in fact, that's largely what the kids' nursery rhyme is. You've all heard the old song, "London Bridge is falling down, falling down, falling down. London Bridge is falling down, my fair lady." Which I have no idea who the fair lady in that song is. There's probably some speculation about that, but I'm not going to be belaboring that song on this particular episode. Mostly, it's just important to know that it was a constant fire hazard from its, very beginning, because they couldn't stop building stuff on it. They would build, it's really incredible. If you can find a picture of the old London Bridge, obviously they're not photos because they didn't have photography back in the 1300s or whatever. But the bridge was as old as that. I think 1209 I have down as a date. That may have been when it was first constructed, kind of as the official version. But they kept building on it. They built buildings and houses and all kinds of stuff on it, just kind of hanging off the side of it, and built it up, seven stories tall. And it was just this constant fire hazard. And so it was constantly having breakdowns and burning down and all kinds of crazy stuff. So you're going to see a theme about that in the song when we get to it. You're going to see kind of how that theme of breaking down and being built back up is used as a metaphor for kind of the human experience generally in this song that was given to us by the band Bread. And it all really came to a head when The London Bridge was taken down for the last time, or at least this particular London Bridge we're talking about, because it was replaced, but it was taken down in 1968 in order to be sold, and it was sold to Havasu Lake City in Arizona. So that's right, the United States, or a state, you know, Arizona state, bought the London Bridge, and they took it all down, they took it apart, they marked every stone, numbered them all so that they could put it back together, and they shipped it off to the United States and put it together in Lake Havasu City, Arizona, and it stands there today. It is the second greatest tourist attraction in Arizona, second only, of course, to the Grand Canyon. And that is a little history of the London Bridge that you may find useful as we go through the song. And then on the other side of it, I'll give you just a little bit of music theory, a little music theory minute about it to point out anything that happens to be interesting on the musical side of the song. And then we will do the deep dive into the lyrics, and we'll go through it line by line and try to determine what David Gates was talking about when he wrote this song for the band Bread. All right, so here is the song. It is called London Bridge, of course, and here you go. I know the times are hard to bear. It's hard to find someone to really care. But before I went down and out, here's what I used to think about. Think about London Bridge was always falling down. There it stood within the heart of town, reminding everyone of life behind and life to come. The changes taking place are everywhere. The centuries past have nothing to compare where they stand or where they trip and fall. Watch the writing on the wall, on the wall. London Bridge has fallen down at last, so another memory of the past has fallen to the blade, but soon the debt may be repaid. Have it, and we're gonna be talking about the musical, or not musical, but the lyrical interpretation of those lyrics. But before we do that, we're going to have our quick music theory minute, where I tell you about something that's interesting about the construction of the song musically. And before we do that, I'm gonna tell you that if you enjoy this podcast, if you would like to ensure its continuation into futurity, you could, if you choose to, if you would like to, if you are compelled thusly, you may visit patreon.com/joelcrow, which is just my name, J-O-E-L-C-R-O-W, And you could donate a dollar or a couple of dollars if you think this podcast merits that. And if you don't, that's perfectly all right. I'd also just encourage you to try to spread word of this podcast by word of mouth. Because I'd love to be creating something that people actually care about and see value in and to get more suggestions for songs to do on this show. But anyway, let's go ahead and go into the music theory minute here. So we are playing this. I'm playing this one in the key of C. It's originally done in the key of E, but I moved it down so that I could, sing it, plausibly. And one of the really interesting things musically about this song is this little bit of dissonance that it enters into, especially between the first chorus and the second verse. He does this little thing that sounds like this. It's almost like, it's almost like a it's got kind of a carnival sound to it, almost, with the, it's like a playful dissonance, I should say. A playful dissonance, kind of a slanted harmony, an unusual harmony that steps outside of the key. And hopefully it brings to mind the idea, I think, what it's trying to indicate. It's kind of a clever musical painting of the idea of something that's breaking down, something that's, it's just not quite right, right? It jars on the ear just a little bit, because you've got it nicely, you've got this nice melody in the key of C, and then when we get to the point, it comes almost out of nowhere where it goes. And that's kind of the same thing, right? It does something kind of interesting. It steps outside of the key and it jars on your ear a little bit. And I think that kind of signifies something breaking down, something being not quite right. It's not within the key anymore. It's not natural. It's not, doesn't feel normal. But in this little part that I was playing you at the beginning, it almost has the indication of right at this end part where it goes, it resolves back nicely into that C chord, and you almost get the impression of the thing that was broken, but it's building itself back up, or it's being built back up. And it's kind of cool how that can relate to the idea of the London Bridge breaking down and then being built back up, which we kind of talked about in the history of the London Bridge, and we'll see more how that pertains in this song. So there's that, and then similarly, there's a neat little walk down that it goes in the chorus, where it's the London Bridge is always falling down, just to stand within the heart of town. You get a little bit more of that dissonance right there, you see. And then resolves back nicely to the C. But just that down, and it kind of gives you the sense of inevitability. It's a sense that, again, something is going down, and something is it kind of relates to the lyrics in that sense as well. And then the next part's real interesting, where it goes up to it's a minor four chord, and then gets even a little bit weirder, stepping even further outside of the key of C. This is a F. This is a, I'm sorry, a C sharp major chord, which resolves at last back down to C, takes it back to the mother key, as it were, back to the natural key where we started, and then starts the cycle over. It's a really clever musical device that helps kind of complements the meaning of the lyrics, as well as just maintaining cleverness, and at least for me, helps me kind of groove along to it a little bit easier, rather than playing along on the same four or five or six chords that seem to be interminably used in a lot of modern music. All right, so that is your Music Theory Minute, and now we'll go on into the main meat of the podcast, where we're going to be going through the lyrics and talking about what the heck he's trying to say. So we start out I know the times are hard to bear. It's hard to find someone to really care. So this is again the idea that we live in an age where it seems like people don't really care, right? The times are hard to bear. It's hard to live in these worlds seemingly because we have this impression that things were so much better in the past, that people cared more about each other, for each other, or even for the things that are going on. And he'll go on to describe a little bit more about why exactly that is the case. But in the meantime, just in the end of this first verse, he only says, but before I went down and out, here's what I used to think about. And here you get that little bit of dissonance there. So before I went down and out, before I let this thought kind of weigh me down and kind of start to lose hope over it, he says, there was this thought that I always used to have, and I think he's starting to question it, the speaker of this song, starting to question the hope that he always entertained before, which is still forthcoming. He's kind of teasing you along, saying, here is this thought that was always here, and of course he's still thinking about it, but feels like that hope is kind of slipping away. And that hope is right here in the chorus, where he says that London Bridge was always falling down. It used to stand within the heart of town, reminding everyone of life behind and life to come. You hear that little kind of brokenness in the music, and then a nice little resolve back to the key of C. So he's relating how he feels about the world today. And this is an American band, by the way. So the idea of the London Bridge almost kind of comes up out of nowhere. It's not really led up to a whole lot. He just says, oh, this is kind of like the idea of the London Bridge, which in so many different contexts in the children's song, or you know, in just its history, it has this sense of always continuously breaking down, falling down. There's always something wrong with it. And then, sure enough, you know, it's always built back up. It's always brought back up. And he's got this idea, this is the idea that he held on to that helped him to keep hope when the times seemed to be uncaring and inhospitable, you could say. He always kept in the thought that, well, yes, things do break down, but they'll be built back up. Yes, there's an ebb and flow to society, to the way that everything goes, and we don't need to give in to, you know, despair, because things have a way of coming back, no matter what. And that was the thought that he used to entertain, you know, before he went down and out, as he says in the verse. And the end of that chorus is really interesting too. It's so it used to stand within the heart of town. So it was an inseparable, it was a core part of that society, but also I think just of nature, just of humanity. It's a core part of us, is kind of what that's saying. It's like the town is a metaphor for humanity. And this is a thing that's stuck inside of us, that emanates out this brokenness and constant breaking down and constant building back up again. And what that does is it reminds us, as he says, it reminds everyone of life behind and life to come. So it's a bridge. Right, it's clever to kind of go back to that idea of it's a bridge between what's behind us and what's in front of us, the past and the future, obviously. And it is a reassuring thing that no matter what happens, no matter what we face, in the past it's been difficult, and in the future it's going to be difficult, but we've always got this assurance that whatever gets broken down can be built up again in the future. And then he goes on in the second verse to talk about why that despair seems to be especially powerful these days. He says, "The changes taking place are everywhere." Oh, yeah. "Centuries past of nothing to compare." Which, yeah, that is so true. I guess every age feels that way, right? I mean, obviously technology brings us further and further farther from everything that we've ever known. But it's not only the technology, but also cultural change. And it really feels like things are snowballing. And of course, remember, this was written back in 68, 69, I think. And so even back then, there was this sense of roller coastering society that was getting further and further away from the steady and trusted and known even things that that we're all familiar with. And we're getting to a point where it even more so, I think today, this really speaks to me today, as we're in this what we call the 24-hour news cycle, and suddenly, you know, every day there's a new catastrophe, there's a new something to think about, there's a new weather, especially this year, right? There's a new pandemic or something. There's always something that's going on that seems to make this world like a crazy random game of Jumanji, right? Every day, every move, it's something new. "Centuries past have nothing to compare." It feels as if they always had something that they could trust in, that they always at least knew the world that they lived in and knew what they could trust in. And now it kind of feels like we're floating around and don't have anything. But that's the impression, at least, that I get from that line. Just constant change, and you can't trust anything to stay the same. And then he says, "Where they stand and where they trip and fall, you watch the writing on the wall." On the wall. So again, the idea of things either standing or tripping and falling, again, it's the idea that there is this constant cycle, even if it seems like nothing is the same, if it feels like things are happening rather randomly, at least there is this one principle that we can trust in, I think, is the idea that he's trying to bring out here, is that at least we know this London Bridge idea, this idea that within us, within humanity, there is this unstoppable tendency to break down and be built back up. Things will stand and then they'll trip and fall inevitably, and whatever happens, you'll watch the writing on the wall. Now, the writing on the wall is a phrase, it's a figure of speech that is not as common anymore than it used to be, but it used to be fairly common, and it always carried the aspect of something ominous. It was a portent of fate. It was a sign that, you know, something bad was going to, it was understood as that. And it's actually a reference, as many old figures of speech are. It's a reference from the Bible. It comes from the book of Daniel, as a matter of fact, in the Old Testament. There's a story of a king named Belshazzar, is the name of the, I believe it's Babylonian king, who is so powerful and proud, and, you know, believes that his kingdom is established for all of eternity. And then the way that in that story God chooses to reveal his ultimate end to him is by giving him this very frightening vision of a disembodied hand that writes words on the wall in front of him, and they're words that at first he doesn't understand, and he has to have them translated, and he has to get an interpretation himself. But he knows in his heart, even before he does any of that, he knows that this is not a good message, this is not a good sign. And the message, of course, when it's translated, basically says, "Your days are numbered, your kingdom will see its end," you know, basically things like that. I think part of it is God has weighed you on the scales and you've been found wanting is, you know, kind of an interesting part of it. But the idea of the writing on the wall is just that your end is coming. You are so high and mighty and you think the most of yourself, but sure enough, your end is coming and you're going to be cast down with the rabble, to the rubble with the rabble. So anyway, you watch the writing on the wall. You understand that things break down, things get built back up, but those who are on top can end up on the bottom. And it can be kind of a reassuring knowledge of the world or a reassuring feeling in the world. And again, he goes on to elucidate on this idea of the London Bridge. He says, "The London Bridge has fallen down at last, so another member of the past has fell beneath the blade, but soon the debt may be repaid." Now, this is a rather ambiguous line, I think. So, the London Bridge is falling down at last, so it's been coming, and he's seeing it fall down again. It's London Bridge, it's a big structure. It's a core part of us that we had found ourselves suddenly trusting in, but we should have known, just like all those people who built their houses on the London Bridge should have known that it was a huge fire hazard and it only took, you know, one cow kicking over a lantern or whatever to set it all up in flames, and everyone loses everything that they've ever built, everything they've ever worked and live their lives for, goes up in flames. But it's all coming down at last, and so another memory of the past. I think I might have said member, because I used to think that was how it goes. But another memory of the past has fell beneath the blade, or fallen to the blade. I might have said at one point as well. Sometimes I, you know, kind of mess around with these little turns of phrases to try to find something that fits the bill, because fell beneath the blade, has fell beneath the blade, is not, you know, ideal English, but whatever. The idea is that you know, what is the blade? What does it represent? What is it talking about? Well, it is the idea again of something that is inevitable. It's the blade is, I think, a representation of fate or destiny. And it is the thing that cuts all things down eventually, right? It's just another memory of the past that has fallen to the blade. But, he says at the end, soon the debt may be repaid. Again, a little bit ambiguous. So what is the debt and what is the repaying of that debt? Well, I think the debt would be potentially a chasm. So if we're thinking about the metaphor of the London Bridge, right? The metaphor of how it spans a space between what has been and what is yet still to come. And when all of that stuff kind of breaks down, all the stuff that we thought that we would be able to trust in, it creates a chasm, and that chasm could kind of be imagined as a debt, right? It's a lacking of something. It's an empty vacuum, you could say. But you know, we say in science, they say nature abhors a vacuum, meaning that, you know, wherever that space exists, it exists so that it will be filled, and it'll be filled very quickly. And so I think that is kind of how it relates to that. That debt may be repaid. What was lacking will be filled in, and the empty vacuum will be satisfied as, once again, you know, something else is built right back up in its place. And they've got this really cool musical interlude. He says, I know things just can't evolve through all eternity. So, there's this kind of a pipe dream, maybe. There's this ideal thought that, well, maybe we can just, you know, move forward and forward and forward and forward and never see any backsliding at all. But the reality that he's facing in this part of the song, he's saying, you know, things just can't keep moving forward that way. There's never going to be a moment where we reach that point of seeing, at least in this world, we'll never reach the point of seeing, you know, nothing but progress. There's always going to be this falling back into things that we used to know in the past and things that we tried to avoid in the past. But there is maybe a little bit of hope here when he says, the thoughts we leave will never die. Now, so you can see. So we die, right? The London Bridge breaks down, and even we and our bodies and even everything that we've ever spoken and wrote will die. But the ideas, the thoughts that we leave behind, the hope or the messages that we have or the desire to make things better, all of those things get sent on into the future. And even though there is this ebb and flow, there is a definite turn towards, you know, what's better and better and better. You know, let me put it this way. The way a average to even, you know, lower middle class person in America lives is really a much, much better life than even the highest king could ever have imagined to live hundreds of years ago. So I always think of this as an example. Hundreds of years ago, a king used to have this grand display of his wealth and pomp and power by bringing in all kinds of incredible edibles from, you know, different parts of the world and you know, things growing when they were out of season where he's at, and just glory in his power and in his wealth that he's able to spread before him an incredible feast, and you know, so much food that he could never eat it. And of course, that's the thing that, you know, the wealthiest kings in the world used to do hundreds of years ago, and today we just call that going to the grocery store. So there is forward progress, is what I'm trying to say. And those thoughts, and that's achieved by thoughts that we leave behind even after we ourselves have died, and even though there is backsliding and there is breaking down and building back up. And it ends on this note of actual hope. Because in the end of this little musical interlude, it ends on this major chord that is actually a key change. It's a shift in the key, where he says, now so you can see, and it goes to the chorus, London Bridge. So what we've done is change the key from C to D, so we've moved up a step. And then he goes on with the last chorus here, the London Bridge's fallen down at last, he says, the London Bridge's finally fallen down, they packed it up and shipped it out of town, and though the heart is gone, the memory will linger on. So we've taken it up a key, so there's this idea, even with all of the little breaking down, in the ultimate kind of destiny of the song, and in the larger view of the song, you wind up going to this new key, the key of D. So it's kind of a clever way to represent that idea of ultimate progress of some kind. And to kind of go through that last chorus, the London Bridge is finally falling down, again just acknowledging what has to be. And then he says they packed it up, shipped it out of town, which hopefully that noun kind of makes sense, right? As we talked about the London Bridge, that is a clear reference to the very last time that London Bridge came down into all its pieces. And that was when it was sold to the guy in Arizona to Lake Havasu City to go there. And they took it all down, just like the song says. They took it down and shipped it out of town, which again is just this crazy, bizarre thing. It still blows my mind to think about it. Like, how in the world was that financially doable? Like, wouldn't it have made a lot more sense to just, build another bridge in America? Even if you couldn't build it in Lake Havasu, couldn't you build it, closer than across the Atlantic Ocean? And all the transportation of all of that stone and material, how could that really be just financially sensible? And then, of course, London is going to build up their own London Bridge again. And it's nuts. Feels totally nuts. It really brings me back to the idea that, the changes taking place are everywhere. Centuries past have nothing to compare. I can't imagine. I don't know of any other situation where, I guess maybe the Statue of Liberty is kind of another example of that. It's another pretty incredible thing that came all the way from France, but this is not a song about the Statue of Liberty. It's another, just another bizarre thing that that happened. It's hard to imagine, and hard to believe it will ever happen again. But who knows? Maybe London is just waiting to sell their bridge again, and then they'll build another one and sell that one eventually. But anyway, to return to the theme of the song, all of this time, the London Bridge was falling down, and they always fought it, and they always, built it back up until the very last time when they themselves, took their hands to it and brought it down for their own purpose. And maybe there is some metaphorical meaning in that, even in the final kind of giving in to that disintegration, that natural breaking down that occurs within nature, and then packing it up and shipping it off, and feeling as if you can feel like he does in the beginning of the song, like it doesn't really matter anymore, and that you're kind of down and out. Or you can have the attitude that that he does have at the end of this song, where he says that though that heart is gone, the memory will linger on. So there'll always be this idea of the London Bridge, this idea of the constant breaking up and breaking down and building back up in society. Anyway, that's really it for the song. It does go back down to the key of C at the very end, and then it goes even further down. If you listen to the original recording, it kind of fades out at that point as it's taken the natural cycle down key by key. But really a cool song. I hope that you enjoyed some of that, and let me know, what do you think about the London Bridge? What do you think about that metaphor? Is there something that I've missed? Is there something that I've misinterpreted? I'd love to hear what you think about it. But in the meantime, I'm going to go ahead and sign off here. I hope that you are staying safe and well. It will actually have been 3 weeks by the time, this gets out there. 3 weeks since you've heard from me before. So I'm trying to get back into the swing of things after all this craziness that we've all experienced. And hopefully you'll be hearing from me again next week, and I will talk to you again. Thank you so much for listening. Of course, if you would like to, if it merits, then you can subscribe to this and give it a thumbs up wherever, or write a comment on YouTube if you like, or write me at my email, which is deepdivelyrics.crow@gmail.com, and interact with me there. Alrighty, hope you're staying well, And remember that whatever breaks down, things will get built back up, and keep a strong bird's eye view of the situation. I'll talk to you again next week. Thank you.